Hey folks, welcome. Whether you're sitting at home on your device, you're maybe watching on the TV, or maybe you're with one of our partner churches, like our friends in Ashley, North Dakota at Zion Lutheran Church or West Moe Lutheran Church out in rural Brandon, whatever brought you here today, we are just honored to spend a little of our day with you. It's so good to be with you. We are in the second week of a worship series we are calling Weird Stuff Christians Do. And the reason we're doing a series like this is we know there are plenty of you out there who are fairly new to the Christian faith. And maybe, I know this, that when you look at some of the things that we do as Christian people, it seems odd. It seems strange. And so we want to take a few weeks to explain, why do we do the things that we do as Christian people? But maybe more importantly, there are many of you who maybe grew up in the faith. You've always been around church, and everything we do, it seems normal because it's what we've always done. And maybe during this series, you will recognize that many of the things that we do appear odd. They appear strange to the 60% of Americans who are not affiliated with church. And here's my prayer. Listen to this. I hope you will recognize that some of the things that we do actually are hindering us from drawing people into the faith that we hold so dear. So today, I want to talk about one of those odd things, strange things, weird things that we Christians do, and that's this: singing, right? Singing. Singing is a strange thing. Where else in your life are you asked to sing publicly? Nowhere. That's where. You sing in your car, you sing in the shower, but nowhere else are you asked to sing. And if you're not so sure, if you're someone who's been going to church all your life and you're not so sure this is a strange thing, well, all you have to do is to scroll social media, check out church sites, and here's what you'll find out.
Hey y'all, this right here is the Bible slide featuring the Freedom Band. And this time, we're about to get holy, 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 holy. Holy, holy, holy.
Do it!
This next and final song is going to be one that has made me pretty famous over the last few years.
Looking for a city where we'll never die.
Amazing grace. I want people to sing with me too. Amazing grace.
Folks, singing can be weird. If you don't recognize that in these videos, you are not awake. We Christians, when it comes to singing, it's just kind of weird. And so we want to wonder with you, why is it that we sing? Why do we do this? It's interesting. What do we do with a baby when that baby first comes into this world? You know what we do. We take that baby, we cuddle it in our arms, and we can't not sing to it. We can't not sing Jesus Loves Me or our favorite lullaby. It's interesting. What do we do at the end of someone's life? Again, we gather together, and what do? We sing at a funeral. Music therapists will tell us that when someone is at the end of their life, even though they've lost all their mental faculties, when you sing with them, they can respond. They hear it. They feel it. There's something powerful about music. Every culture in the world, sociologists will tell us, they sing. And before there was even a spoken language, scientists, historians, they know that people sang. Singing is powerful. You know this, because when you get in the car and you crank up the radio, what do? You can't not tap your hand on the steering wheel, right? When I get into my truck and I crank up the 80s music, I can't not drive a little bit faster. There's something powerful about music. And here's what I think. The ancient authors of the Bible, when they sat down and penned the words of the Bible, they knew that. Because in the Bible, get this, singing is referenced over 400 times. And do you know what's right in the middle of our Bible? A songbook. The book of Psalms is a songbook. Many of those psalms written by King David. Psalms like this one. Come. Let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. In Psalm 96, we hear this. Let the whole earth sing to the Lord. Sing to the Lord and praise his name. In Psalm 105, give thanks to the Lord and proclaim his greatness. Let the whole world know what he has done. Sing to him. Tell everyone about his wonderful deeds. We hear in Psalm 149, praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing his praises in the assembly of the faithful. Let the praise of God be in their mouths. Again and again, the authors of the Psalms, they write these words about singing. Again, in Psalm 150, the best way to spread Christmas cheer is singing loud for all to hear. That's actually not the psalm. It's actually Buddy the Elf. But in all seriousness, here's what the authors of the Bible knew, that music was powerful. And so over 400 times, they reference singing. Jesus even says, if you all won't sing, even these rocks will sing out praises to God. Now, I can see you, and some of you aren't so sure about this. You're sitting there, your arms crossed, and you're saying, I just don't sing. I don't know if you recognize this, but I just don't sing. I'm of Norwegian descent, Swedish descent. I come from a long line of stubborn Germans. We don't sing. And here's what you need to know, Pastor. I'm not expressive. That's just not who I am. I grew up on a farm in nowhere, North Dakota. We are not expressive people. Now, here's what I want to say to you. I know what you do after church in the fall, right? I know you go home, you crack open a beer, pull out the Doritos, and what do you watch on TV? You watch the Vikings, you watch the Packers, you watch football, and do you know what you look like? You look the same as I do. You look like this when the game is on, right? You yell at the television, you scream at the television, you throw things at the television, you swear, you cry, you pout. Folks, come on, don't tell me you're not expressive. Here's what I think. Most of us are expressive, but we're just not expressive with God. I mean, think about the last time you shot that big old buck. Let me tell you, there were probably some chest bumps amongst the guys, right? Your son, when he shot that first pheasant, you held that pheasant up like you were in the Lion King, right? You are expressive. Think about this. Maybe you were at the gym last week, and when you were pushing up that last rep, you better believe you were expressive. Girls, when you got together with your girlfriends for girls' night, you walked into the bar, into the restaurant, and you squealed with excitement when you saw all your girlfriends. Everyone in the restaurant knew that you were there, right? Don't tell me you're not expressive. You closed that deal at work. There were fist bumps all around, right? Don't tell me you're not. Here's the thing. Most of us are expressive. We're just not expressive with God. So, again, back to my question, why do we sing? The first reason I think we sing as followers of Jesus is this. Singing helps us remember what God says to us. Singing helps us remember what God says to us. Think about the songs that get stuck in your head. You know the words because of the tune. For example, there are silly Christmas songs like this. You remember, all I want for Christmas is my what? My two front teeth. Or how about this one? Grandma got run over by what? By a reindeer. If you're a Neil Diamond fan, here's a Neil Diamond song. Sweet Caroline. Everybody say it. Bop, bop, bop. Right? We remember it because the tune carries the words. And the same is true for the songs that are important to us. The songs of our faith. They remind us of God's promises to us. Here's what I know. Many of you, you might have a spouse who, when this message is done on the way home in the minivan, they might say, hey, what did you think of Pastor Hans's message? And you will have no clue. You will have forgotten my message, but you will be humming a tune, right? Tunes help us remember. Singing helps us remember what God says to us, God's promises, God's love for us, the words that God shared while he roamed this earth. In the Psalm 150 says this, let the message of Christ dwell among you richly. Let it dwell deep inside of you through singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Why do we sing? It's because singing helps us remember God's word. The second reason I think we sing is this. Singing expresses what's inside of you. Singing expresses what's inside of you. When you're having a great day, what do? You go to your Spotify list and you pull out songs like this. You play songs like this, like Happy by Pharrell Williams, right? It just feels good. I'm so happy, right? Or if you're of another vintage, you might pull out the Beatles, Here Comes the Sun. Here comes the sun. Who doesn't like that song? If you just broke up with your boyfriend or your girlfriend, you might pull up Adele, Someone Like You. Or if you're of another vintage, it's going to be Whitney Houston, I Will Always Love You. Or how about this? If your boyfriend just cheated on you, you're going to pull out some Carrie Underwood, right? Remember that one? Louisville Slugger to His Front Headlights. Why do we sing? Because singing expresses what's going on inside of you. When you come to worship and you've been through a season of your life where you've made a mistake, maybe you screwed up, or you've been hurt, you're in that spot that you just wished you weren't in. When you sing the song, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound That Saved a Wretch Like Me, it means something more. When we in modern worship, we sing, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour, I need you. These words, they express what's going on inside us. The emotions that seem to have this way of bouncing around inside of singing expresses what's going on inside you. And lastly, here's why I think we sing, and maybe this is the most important one. Singing moves you from a spectator to a worshiper. It moves you from being a spectator to being a worshiper. If you've been a part of our Calvary family for very long, here's what you know. For us, faith is not a spectator's sport. If you're new to faith, new to the church, you can sit back and watch for a while. But here's the truth. Faith worship is not a spectator sport. Spectators, what do? They come to be entertained. But worshipers come to get engaged. They come to participate. Spectators, what do? They hold their coffee and they sort of hide behind that cup of coffee when the music comes up. What do worshipers do? They start to move to the music. If you're there and you're there as a spectator, what do? You're checking your phone. You're ordering things at Target during worship. But if you are a worshiper, your eyes are fixed on the screen. You are engaged. Worshipers know that they are part of the choir, whether they are up front or they are sitting in the pews. They know that we all are part of the choir. Now, you might say, well, I don't sing. I can't sing. Well, good for you. In church at Calvary, we don't have auditions. We believe that singing is sort of like life. We do the best we can with the tools God has given us. Right? When we sing, we're moved from being just simply a spectator to being a worshiper. And God invites us to be worshipers. So I can see you again. You're sitting there. So what do I do? I mean, I don't sing. My dad didn't sing. My grandfather did. My great-grand, we just don't sing. So smart, Pastor, what do I do? Well, here's what I want to invite you to consider. Take a next step. Just take a little baby step. When you come to worship, if you're one of those guys, I see you, who does this when the music starts, right? Maybe you'll just put your hands down. Just put, drop your shoulders. Just breathe and take the music in. Maybe you're one of those people who's the coffee sipper during music. Just put the cup down. Maybe you're someone who says, I don't sing. Well, just try this. Just try humming the music. Maybe you're someone who already you sort of hum every once in a while. Well, maybe you might do this. You might actually consider singing the chorus. You don't even have to sing loud enough so the person next to you hears you. And maybe you're someone who sings every once in a while, and it's time for you to just let loose. Just sing out. God said, make a joyful noise. And maybe you're someone who already comes and you sing at the top of your lungs. And maybe for you, you just need to get all those emotions that are inside of you out, and you need to throw your hands in the air. It's funny. I grew up in a Lutheran home, and we attended a Lutheran Norwegian church. And in that Lutheran Norwegian church, if your hands were in the air, you better be having a heart attack, right? We just didn't do those sorts of things. Now, I don't know about you, but the older I get, the more I've got all these emotions inside of me. I tear up during a song, and I've got all these emotions that are just bouncing off the walls inside of me. And I've realized something, that I express more emotion when I'm watching a football game, when I went to a Garth Brooks concert. I express more emotion there than I ever do at church. And here's the thing. There's something wrong with that. Wherever you're at, we all are invited to take a next step. Whether that's just taking your hands from this to this, maybe it's just taking that next step to start humming the tune, or maybe for you, it's throwing your hands in the air because you're so thankful for what God has done for you. Hey, there's one last reason that we sing, and this is an important one. I want you to know, sometimes your neighbor needs you to sing for them. Sometimes your neighbor needs you to sing for them. Here's what I know. There are some of you who are watching today, and you are spent. You've just had it. You've had it up to here. Maybe it's with your kids, or maybe you've had this conflict at work, or maybe you've got financial woes, or maybe you got that diagnosis, and you have had it. And the thought of singing, not today, thank you very much. I remember shortly after COVID for me as a pastoral leader was one of the hardest things I ever had to live through. It challenged every bit of my leadership skills, and I hope we never have to go there again. But it was shortly after we came out of that my dad's health declined. And in September of 2021, he would pass away. And I remember coming to church, and I'd sit down in the pew, and I just couldn't sing. I just didn't have it in me. And when songs would play, I would just tear. I would well up. And I remember looking around and being so thankful that the congregation was singing for me, that they were carrying a tune that I just couldn't carry that day. And it was their song, their music, that lifted me up when I needed to be lifted up. And here's what I know, the same is true today, wherever you are at. Sometimes we sing because our neighbor needs you to sing for them. Folks, one of the weird things we Christians do is we sing. Why do we sing? Well, singing helps us practically remember what God wants to say to people like you and me. Why do we sing? It allows us to express on the outside what's going on inside. Why do we sing? Because it moves us from being spectators to being worshipers. Why do we sing? Because sometimes your neighbor just needs you to sing for them.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true.
'Cause I am found, I am yours, I am loved.
You now to join with me as together we pray the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. And all God's people said, Amen. Hey folks, thanks so much for tuning in today. We're honored you chose to spend just a little of your day with us. If you are new to Calvary, we would love for you to head out to our website and to take just a baby next step with us. We'd love for you to hit that button that says sign up for emails. It's the easiest way for you to connect with us and us to connect with you. We'll shoot you out an email every Friday sharing all the ways that you can jump on board with us here at Calvary and join us on the journey of faith. Once a year, we invite all of you to do something really special. Here at Calvary, we are doubling down on the ministry to our kids and students. At Calvary, if there's one thing we all agree on, it's this. The faith of the next generation is worth everything, whatever it takes. And so one time a year, we pause to invite you to invest, make an investment in our kids and our students, to make an investment in the faith of the next generation, if you will. Pause for a minute and take a look at this.
Calvary, I want to say thank you. Ever since I was a little baby, you invested in me. You showed me that you cared. I knew that I was safe, valued, and loved.
You celebrated with me at my baptism. You took great care of me in the nursery.
You taught me the stories of Jesus when I was in preschool, and we even dug deeper in elementary school.
We had so much fun together at Vacation Bible School. I still sing the songs in my head every day. I made friendships that will last my whole life.
You taught me how to be a leader, how to serve others with kindness and compassion. You nurtured my biggest faith questions and made a safe place for me to explore my doubts.
You brought me mentors and small group guides to help me on my faith journey. You gave me the chance to explore the world God made. You invested in my faith. Thank you.
Calvary, would you invest in the faith of the next generation? Would you invest in kids and students like me?
This month, we're looking for stockholders to invest in our faith journeys. Shares are $50, and they support Calvary's kids and students in programs like the High School Houseboat Trip, Vacation Bible School, and Bible Camp.
Please visit a table in the hub or donate on Calvary's website.
Your investment matters more than you'll ever know.
Thank you for investing in us.
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 Pretty powerful, huh? Here's what we invite you to do. You can take stock in our youth. You can purchase a $50 share in our youth program. It's a way that you can invest. You can buy one, two, you can buy 20 shares if you want. It's our way of supporting the critical kid and student ministries today that will influence them for a lifetime. Thank you ahead of time for taking stock in our students. As we close today, I just want to say thank you for your generosity. It's because of your generosity that Calvary is a growing, thriving church in central Minnesota. We are so grateful. As we close, you can make your offerings in any of the ways on the screen. The first and maybe the easiest is to simply go to our website, click the button that says give. You can sign up for a one-time, or I want to have you consider signing up for a reoccurring gift. You can also use that app on your phone, Venmo, or you can write a check, drop it in the mail to the address on the screen, or if you want to make a special gift this week, we'd love to talk to you about living that generous life that God is calling us all to. Give us a call in the church office. Thanks so much for tuning in today. Have a good one.